Okay, well, stragglers may arrive, but thank you for coming, avoiding the bar and early airport exit and all those things to make it to the final session on Thursday. So, my name's Andrew. I'm speaking on behalf of Delta Publishing, who published our book, Teaching Lexically. And what I'm going to be talking about is dialogue building, which actually doesn't feature in our book, which is perhaps slightly strange, but it's, as we'll see later, it kind of does. It's complicated. So, dialogue building, hands up. Who has done it? Yeah, I'm sorry to say there's a certain age difference there,
I remember from my course.
Exactly, yes, yeah. I mean, I did my TEFL course before it was called a CELTA in 1991. And the dialogue build was, just thought, was a brilliant thing, and it just, my impression has been that it's been fading out of CELTA courses, and I think that's a great pity, because there are some very useful skills which are associated with it, which are good for teachers, but as we'll see, I hope, also it kind of, it can show a different view of language and a different approach to teaching. So, sorry, we're going to do it. You're going to have to take part. But obviously, because it's a multilingual audience, we're doing a nonsense language, okay? So it's completely made up. The problem with this, obviously I did this, I put in my proposal last year. Didn't think about, oh my God, I'm going to have maybe 100 people in the class. 15 maybe. Didn't think about whiteboards being missing. So there are some certain things which aren't quite how they might be in the classroom. But let's have a go. So the first, what we're going to learn is, have you been to Scotland before? Okay. And the way we say this in my language is, estades gos brev. Estades gos brev. Okay, everybody, estades gos brev. One more time.
Estades gos brev.
Estades gos brev.
Yeah, yeah.
Estades gos brev.
Yeah, yeah.
Estades gos brev.
Estades gos brev.
Estades gos brev.
Nah, is that?
Is that?
Yeah. Okay.
Is cos pref.
Ne. Is that?
Is that? Is that is cos pref.
Very good. Yeah, yeah. Ne. Is that? Is that is cos? Okay. So, what are we saying here? So what was the question? Estades gos brev. Okay. And it means? Yeah. And reply here. So we had estades gos brev. I gave you some replies.
Ne.
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 Yeah, okay. No. Estad.
Ne.
Have you?
Ne.
Estad. Or we could go.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so with a partner, have the little conversation. But wait, you can continue a little bit in English if you like. That's fine. Okay, so go.
Yeah?
Somebody else turn around. Bob's gone. Don't enjoy yourselves too much. It's worse to come yet. Okay. So the question was again? Very good. Learning. And the answer? Different. Maybe a couple.
Yes.
I heard.
Yeah.
Yes. As I was going round, they said, "Is that it's gospel bread?"
Yeah.
Bavici. Bavici.
I live here.
I live here. Exactly. Bavici. Okay. Bavici. Everybody. Bavici.
Bavici.
Lovely. Excellent. Yeah. Doing well. Okay. Did anybody want to? We had yeah. Did anybody want to maybe add a little bit? So here we go. Yeah. Yeah. Livel brev one am. Livel brev one am. Yeah. I was here. I went here. I went there one year.
Livel brev one am.
There. Mistake. Sorry. Yeah. We'll come back to mistakes in a moment. Yes, or if it was any suggestions?
Two.
Yes, two. Well done. Yes. So give me the whole sentence there.
Livel brev tu un.
Livel brev tu tu ani. Tu ani. Close. Well done. Yeah, livel brev tu ani.
Tu ani.
Livel brev tu ani. Everybody? Excellent. Okay. Okay. And anybody like to go? Yes. If it was four.
Livel brev four
anis. Four anis. Ani. No,
no, not anis.
Excellent. Yeah, that's for drinking. Yes. Okay. Yes. And maybe, why were you here 4 years ago? Any suggestions? Yeah. IATEFL passed. IATEFL passed. Okay, so off we go. Have a little conversation. It's that it's got spread, but try and add a little bit. You can choose one of these things. Okay. Off you go. Go.
There is a question about that. Is that this gospel?
Is that
this
gospel?
Yes. Level one an. Bono. Yeah, okay.
And is that this gospel?
Ne.
Yeah. Multitempi. Have family. So, and we're going to ask some question here. Obviously, we can ask some different questions, I guess. Why? What?
Family day.
Very good. Yeah, do you remember what it was in my language? The language Mandarin.
close, yeah, yeah. Have familiage. Have familiage. Have familiage. So, is that London?
Yeah. Liber prev tuani.
Ah, e bono?
Yeah.
Yeah. that Edinburgh?
Nah, sorry. is that?
Nah.
End of conversation.
Never mind. Okay. Is that Aberdeen?
Ne? Sorry. Is that?
Is that?
Is that?
Yeah. Oof. Oh.
2007.
Yeah, multi. Ah, yeah. Livel prev. Ten hours. Let IATEFL past. Okay. So, everybody stand up. You may go and ask other people about places you've been. Is that London? Is that? Good correction, thank you. To student. Remember, if you could continue in English if you like. That's fine. No, again, change partner, find something. Yes, yeah. Okay, we're going for like this one, okay.
Yeah. How was it? Comfoy. Comfoy. Everybody?
Comfoy.
My comfoy. And that is hand. My comfoy. Answer, any suggestions? Oh, close. No, I didn't mention it before. Anybody get it? Bono. Bono. Yeah. Thank you too for you YouTube fans. Think the opposite for you non YouTube fans. Yeah, we could go. Bono. Yeah, too many. It's obviously a great thing. If it's just Bono. And Lady Bono. Or
Ne Bono.
Bono. Bono. So, again, just with the partner. Let us continue. So, is that wherever? Yeah. You come for it. Have a go. Is that Manchester?
Yeah.
E Comfoy? Comfoy?
Bono.
Sì. Yeah. Bono. Sì. We could ask qua, we won't go into this bit, but basically we could then take it a little bit further and ask why. So we could then get ideas from students, and again, using English, perhaps, and then just translating. So for example, the ideas, le popola, le foi bono. The people weren't very friendly, weren't nice. Le clada, le foi bono. Any ideas about that? The weather, that's right. Yes, yeah. The weather. Yeah, think of clouds. E le ristorante, le foi bono. Le city, the city is great. The street is nice.
Yeah, okay. The restaurants are good.
Yeah. So we got, yes, the restaurants the food was nice. Restaurants were nice. Okay. Oh dear. There's a missing bit there, my God. Okay. Yes. So, what I'd like you to do, just stop for a moment and with the person next to you, how do you feel about the experience? What kind of skills could this be useful for training? What kind of skills do you need to do it? Is there anything, any other lessons in terms of language and teaching? Okay? Discuss with your partner about it. Okay, any comments there? Just go through. So I had a picture which I wanted to put, but I messed up, sorry. Any comments so far?
Frustrating.
Frustrating, yeah. Tell me about your frustrations. Yeah, okay.
You could remember things.
Yes, okay. So, I think we're in a slightly restricted time, so normally, and obviously there's a smaller group, so normally what would be happening is there would be more individual drilling, checking, so some of that would hopefully kind of deal with that. Could you learn any of it?
I used that as a teacher, but I
would
hate it as a learner.
Right, okay, we'll come back to it.
I think it might help if you spoke the R1 with your students.
Yes.
Because then if they get stuck and say, well, I want to say the restaurants are good or whatever,
yes,
then you need to be able to say it. So either you need to speak the R1, and if it's a multi-level class, that might also be a bit of a challenge.
So,
you're in their country.
Yes, so the point about translation is a crucial one, which we'll be mentioning as we go further on. The multilingual one, I think what we need to bear in mind is this is complete beginner for all of you in this class. Whereas it's very unusual for us. I mean, I included the numbers because I assume that that is a kind of thing that, well, basically everybody in our classes would know, even the minimum one would normally know from 1 to 10. So it's not that they're complete beginners. So there's an element there that the multilingual class, my impression is it's unusual. I mean, maybe in some ESOL settings, perhaps, where there's maybe literacy problems, perhaps. But in many cases, they will be able to say things like restaurant, and they might say good, and we might teach them great. So there's often will be something which you can cling on to in which they can express themselves, and then we kind of develop it. Any other comments?
Just coming back to the memory thing, I found it phenomenally hard to remember, and therefore I needed that visual prompt.
Yes.
And a lot of people with dialogue will say, oh, you don't show them the dialogue because it impedes their pronunciation, which is garbage.
I think it's good to see it. Certainly is the first thing, but we want to see it. But there is some moment that we have to remove that, I think. That there has to come a point where we do it, at least they attempt the memory, the recall, and then we bring it back and we revisit it. And maybe the next time we see the whole dialogue, perhaps they start off with the whole dialogue written down. Then maybe we actually give them 2 or 3 minutes to sit and try and memorize it from the thing. So there's a couple of stages which we perhaps might have avoided. Anything else? Yeah?
Just in relation to a couple of things. This is, as you said, completely beginner. You can do this and I have done successfully, seen it done very successfully at very high level.
Well, this is something, again, we shall be returning to. So I'm going to, unfortunately, I had this, I was going to show you, I've been teaching this friend of mine Spanish. Now, I'm not a fluent Spanish speaker by any means, but what was interesting was that He is, basically. I mean, I showed him the top 100 verbs, or there is probably the top 20 verbs in Spanish, and he knew about 10 of them. Yet, he could, we started off with the usual thing, de donde eres, which is where are you from, place. We then asked, you know, what part. But then where we moved it a bit further was things like, do you know it? And then, have you been there? Mm-hmm. And a simple, yes, I went there last year or a few years ago. And what was interesting, he wrote, what I have here is a series of dialogues that he wrote, where he produced these things. Present perfect, past simple, for you only, and I only. Not they, we, and all those other ones, but yeah, for the purposes of his conversation, he covered all of these things. Not always correctly. And, you know, I had to correct certain things. Occasionally I corrected them wrongly. But I think, for me, it was quite good. It's quite a good experience as a kind of non-native speaker of Spanish, teaching that level. Because what I felt was that I spoke so much better than he did. It was quite a kind of boost for my confidence from that point of view. But also at the same time, I was recognising that I didn't have all the information at times. But what I felt I was teaching him was something close to real life conversation, which he might actually take part in. And it was an enabling process, even though it might not actually be perfectly native-like, or there may be certain errors on occasion. So I'm kind of thinking about that in terms of perhaps, you know, your experience if you're a non-native speaker, teacher. So what I'm going to do is just go briefly through some of my views of how dialogue building can contribute. So the first very important thing is the value of L1. Now, how did we get the meaning across? In English, how long did it take? Like a second, a couple of moments. None of this photos, pictures, the desperate trawling action. Please tell me the words I want you to say. What are you thinking, teacher? No, we just told them, it means this, and that's how you say it. Let's try and say it. So off we go. Similarly, I think there's the value of where did some of the extensions to the language, to the conversation come from. Now, in real life, where I have a board and there's a smaller group, I would be going more directly from what the students actually want to say. There's a certain amount of prediction, which I'll also come back to then. But you can, you know, the students can speak in their own language. Now, I understand, as I say, in the point you made earlier about multilingual, that may be a small impediment, but I think it's less than you might imagine, and we can kind of build on it. But for me, people who abandon L1, I just find it, I don't know, bizarre, frankly, in a beginner or elementary class, particularly, because it's just the easiest way to get the meaning across. And they have a great resource. They are natural speakers, and we can use the way the language develops, the conversation develops, naturally in most languages. And what was interesting, we had one at the beginning, but I can't remember which one it was, that you can kind of predict that it means I live here, partly because you understand how that conversation works in your own language. So I think it's one of the great benefits of dialogue building. Pressing more one. Second point is, as I kind of hinted at, we've had present perfect, present simple, past simple in that dialogue. You are complete beginners, albeit that, you know, sometimes we find it frustrating, we can't remember everything. But essentially, the grammar is not really what's holding us back there. it's a kind of memory thing. And if we treat at the lowest levels, and some other levels I think we'll come back to again, grammar as words sometimes, it's incredibly enabling. As I mentioned with my friend Ian, he doesn't get it right all the time by any means, but it enables him to have that conversation. And he's been one of these people who's been learning endlessly, you know, 1 or 2 weeks here and there, and kind of not really getting it. He found it's kind of positive about having a real conversation. It's quite motivating, I think. Students as a resource, I kind of mentioned anyway. So it can be just because they are through their, using their own language. But also, as I say, and particularly the point Howard was making there about higher levels, which we'll come back to in a moment. At higher levels, often what it'll be is just there'll be a start of a conversation in class, you might correct it, and then it's kind of asked, well, how would you reply to this? And then how would you reply to that? And so the building takes place with the students, and what they're coming back with is a higher level of language. And you're using how they understand these conversations work. Occasionally, they may be slightly different in their language and your language, and you have to correct that aspect of it. Okay? Well, you would say that, yeah, we wouldn't kind of say that. It sounds too, I don't know, informal or too direct or whatever. And you can help them through that process. Teacher talk. I've had a discussion earlier with somebody about this. Dialogue building, I think maybe one of the reasons it fell out of fashion is it's apparently very teacher-centered. The teacher is doing a lot of the talk, the teacher is organising the class, a lot of it is going through the teacher, although you did quite a lot of work as well. And again, well, the teacher to me is just providing the language, it's teaching. Rather than teacher talk, it's just teaching, let's keep it at that. The other part of that is that you can kind of predict, with a lot of conversations, you can have an idea of how they will develop. And you can, before the class, as I did, I mean, basically, prepare the language to some extent. Okay, I'll come back to that in a moment as well. Obviously, this is kind of point that was made here. This is an essential repetition. Actually, it was probably less than I would normally have in a class. The other part that we didn't do was that at some point I would ask the students to write down the conversation, maybe write their own ones. So I asked Ian to do. There will be mistakes made, but they will kind of find ways, maybe they will start wanting to add questions. I think this is the other thing about this style of dialogue building. If you're including the students as a resource and asking them, well, what do you think might go next? When they come to do a timed writing on their own, thinking about it, they will kind of say, well, maybe I'll say this, actually, in this conversation. And they will ask you, how do I say, for example, I worked there before, or it's a beautiful city, or these kinds of things, and you fill in those moments, perhaps, in the quieter moments when they're writing their conversations down. Obviously, if we're going to do this properly, I would then ask you to see if you can remember how much of the conversation at the end of the class, maybe have a repetition there, following lesson. When I teach Ian, actually, we start the conversation, you know, basically most lessons start in a quite similar way, actually. We start having the same conversation quite often. But the conversation then tends to go into slightly different directions. So, I mean, particularly things, again, at a lower level, we think about what did you do at the weekend? I mean, these are kind of classic chat conversations, which we don't perceive as learning opportunities and teaching opportunities. This would be a classic way of developing a conversation. So depending on what they answer to what you did at the weekend, the next step, it's that next step. We're asking, what question would you ask about, you know, if I went shopping, as opposed to if I went to a museum, or if I went to a concert. And the conversations might develop in a different way. and you might choose one student to develop their conversation, or the class might practice. On another occasion, you might choose a different student and develop it in that way. And then the last thing is, I simplified certain things, so I didn't say like the convoy. We didn't have "it was great," we just had "bono bono." Mm-hmm. Similarly, in the replies, we didn't have "ya es dat," you know, "have you been?" "Yes, I have you been?" It wasn't that kind of thing, it was just yes or no. And these kind of simplifying, making some decisions to make the conversation simpler, but keeping it relatively natural. Now, the way we in most course books work is the way it's simplified is to simplify the grammar. And you know, we can only do present simple for the first three units, or you know, regulars only before we do irregulars, etc. What I would suggest is no, we can include some of these things, but for example, we can simplify it by just dealing with I and you, the you questions and the I reply, for example. Yeah? This is not to say that we don't then look at a later date at kind of grammar focused on some of these things. And then the last thing is just aspects of skills, which I think are useful for students, trainees, teachers to learn. Drilling. But drilling here in a very useful context, because it's something you're going to drill, get students to repeat, getting everybody to say it at the same time. These aren't necessarily easy tasks, we need practice in them. But we're doing it in a way which they are then actually going to use this language, so it has more point to it, as opposed to certain drilling kind of random grammar sentences, because it's part of our NFP process that we have to have meaning, form, pronunciation, and it can sound a bit odd sometimes. The board writing, here we didn't see it, but actually the process where we're getting the students' ideas, we're writing them on the board, as Bill was mentioning, you guys, that they need to see this, see it written down. And managing changing interactions. These are kind of pace of the lesson. So maybe, you know, you notice the students getting frustrated, so you kind of slow it down, you do an extra stage of repetition. Listening, maybe the most important, actually listening to what the students are saying, both in terms of correcting pronunciation, again, a bit difficult in the larger group, but also listening to what they might want to actually say and helping them say it. So all of these are kind of useful skills, and I think maybe, you know, that doing dialogue builds, whether you, you know, I think I take the point actually that, you know, this is not something you can do every day in this style. It would be quite exhausting for both teachers and students, I think. But in terms of learning it as a training tool, being able to do it, I think it has, you know, incredible value, because those skills I take into lots of other parts of my teaching, which is where we come to the book sale and you know, my marvellous Teaching Lexically book. So, had to be at some point. So, with Teaching Lexically, part of our idea is a lot of these kinds of books work on the basis of recipes. They're things you can do in the classroom, little games or whatever, to practice some area of language. The way we conceive it is actually, we come from a kind of lexical view of language, which is, I think, kind of half proven by the value of what we did here, because there is no problem learning phrases which include difficult grammar above level if we treat them as words. There is actually no, there's anybody at the lowest level, as you've just shown, can master, not master, but, you know, get your heads around and have some basic conversation on these ones. So that's partly where we came from, but we recognise that within course books, they're very much driven by a kind of grammar syllabus, and, you know, these kinds of conversations would not happen in any beginner or elementary book, except possibly elementary innovations. Oh, we all remember it, but not many people. Not many people, as it turned out. Yeah. So part of the way we thought about it was actually, well, I mean, we do a lot of these. I mean, we do use other people's materials sometimes, and it's how you can operate with a slightly more lexical view of life and teaching with other materials. So we take little exercises, looking, if you've got a grammar exercise in your book, how might you adapt that or treat it in a kind of slightly lexically viewing kind of way. So each exercise has these kind of, they're split into different sections, and there are various little kind of exercises for teachers to think about, which we hope they could use every day rather than as one-off types of activities. So, for example, feedback on speaking, cheating. So, you know, a lot of new teachers find it difficult to give feedback. They find it difficult to react to what students have said. And one of the things I usually tell them, and one thing which helped me enormously, and I still do regularly, because you can't always hear what students are saying, is I think about what might be in the conversation, and I prepare a series of sentences which I think might be useful for that conversation, and I have a little gap in it, perhaps. And after they've done their activity, I go, oh, I happen to hear somebody who lived here already. Guess what they said? Bavici. Yeah, okay. And then we kind of prepare it and give it to them. Or you can have a gap sentence and get them to do it. So that's the principle that we present. We have a couple of ideas of types of conversation they might be doing in class, and then we get them to think about how they might cheat for these kind of speaking tasks and how we might develop them. The chat is kind of what I mentioned before about the what did you do last night. The many kind of starting little chat conversations that we have, and getting teachers to think about how those conversations develop, and getting to write a little conversation so that perhaps they become prepared that when it happens, they have this chat, student finds it difficult, they can help and do a kind of mini dialogue build at that moment. Okay? Grammar reformulating student ideas, nothing particularly new. Basically, again, taking the idea of what the students are saying, reformulating it in the correct way, but then getting them to think, well, what would you say next? What comment would go with this sentence? So it's taking the ideas, actually, of the dialogue build and applying them at higher levels. You know, you could do this at any level, basically. And taking that skill, if you like, and practice it in this way. And then the last one is a very similar kind of idea, but maybe taking, you know, sometimes often in grammar exercises, they tend to be often randomish sentences. Some are things which you would never say, or can't imagine ever saying, but often there'll be good examples as well. And it's then taking that good example, deciding yourself what might be the good example within that exercise, and then either doing it yourself as a dialogue build, or just getting the students to think about how they might integrate that sentence within a little dialogue. So thinking what went before it and what went after. This came from a book which I still find very interesting, which was Messaging by George Woolard. It's an e-book, you can find it online. So those are the ideas, and that is, I think, basically. So yeah, just the kind of last kind of plug in a way, is basically the idea is not a recipe book, it is a teacher development book. We follow kind of principles from our own view of language and our own views of teaching, and we try to give them practical ideas of employing that. We present it as one way of doing things. It is our way. But I think that often too much, you know, books are, you can do it this way. But what is the principles driving these choices? So we try to present one way. It's not the only way. People teach lots of ways. So we obviously think it's a good way because we've written a book about it. But we would never consider it like the dialogue build as a magic bullet. It's not, my friend Ian is not a fluent speaker of Spanish. He's not going to go out and be able to use it brilliantly in all aspects. But in this particular area of dialogue, he's learned something that he can make use of. And that's it. Thank you very much. Anybody got any questions? I mean, it's the last one, so
it's like
the advantage. We could stay here all night. No?
Andrew, I had one. Yes. With your mate Ian, because you're traditional, we kind of elicited it from the students. That's quite difficult here because we didn't know the language, so you had to feed us it.
Yes.
But usually it's familiar language from the students. With him, are you kind of eliciting or feeding or a mixture of both?
Well, basically, I do exactly what I did here. So I translate the first bit, and then I ask him what he might want to say next. And then, sorry, just before I go, you can, if you want, we're doing courses in London. If you want to enter our competition, you can just send an email, info@lexicallab.com. Subject, IATEFL prize draw, and just send, give us your name. And you can apply for a free course. Course only, I'm afraid, no accommodation or any other questions? Yeah, no, good, thank you.